So just a quick recap of what we talked about in terms of the fine-grained soils. Remember, fine-grained soils were essentially the soils that are smaller than 75 microns, sieve number 200, right? And you essentially have to see if more than 50% of the material are essentially smaller than a specific sieve size that we have. And essentially, the behavior of the material is predominantly influenced by the surface properties, right? And what we mean by surface properties have to do with the activity of the surface of the clay. In the graduate level courses, we'll talk about the charge deficiency of the surface of the clays and how that is going to be neutralized by the adsorption of the dipolar water molecule. So the whole purpose of the attachment of the water molecule to the surface of the clays, expansion, plasticity, and anything that is associated with that has to do with the charge deficiency of the crystalline structure of the clays. But this is something that you might be able to talk about in another juncture. But at this point, we are looking at the surface activities. What surface activity essentially means is that we're looking at the properties on the surface. The implication of that is particle size, gradation distribution, and the geometry are not players now, right? There are other parameters that are important, such as percent fines present in the mix and the cohesiveness or stickiness or plasticity of the material. Alright, so we talked about the cohesiveness. Remember, you have two types of bonding between the materials. That's something that we talked about again in our previous lectures. You have cohesive bonds and you have adhesive bonds. Adhesional and cohesional components of the attachment of two particles or similar particles. What was the distinction between the two?
Cohesive like particles.
Yes, basically cohesion is essentially happening between similar particles, right? On the other side, adhesional component has to do with two dissimilar particles, such as, let's assume that you're looking at your concrete material, right? For concrete, you have mortar, you have aggregate, right? Two different types of entities. Essentially, they attach to one another and provide the adhesive bonding between them. On the other hand, if you have only clay soils, or you have very fine grain material, you don't have any other type of material in between. There is no glue, and it's only going to be similar material, right? So it's going to be cohesional component. Later on in chapter 8, you'll see that when we talk about the behavior of granular soils in terms of the strength properties, you'll see that the strength of the material has two major components. And one of the components, which is predominantly influencing the behavior of fine-grained soil, has to do with the cohesion component, attachment of the material together and essentially providing good load-bearing capacity. Alright, so that's basically the two major components of the characterization of fine-grained material. So for fine grains, you need to know what is the fine content, and the second component is the stickiness of that, which we call it the plasticity of the material, right? In order to come up with the plasticity of the soil, what kind of test we should run? Atterberg limits, right? So Atterberg limits came from the name Albert Atterberg. In 1900s, he developed a system to be able to characterize the surface properties, right? Those simple index properties that you get quickly do that in the lab to be able to get an indication of that charge efficiency, moisture adsorption capacity, although, and ultimately figuring out what would be the moisture adsorption capacity of the soil is. So that's basically what we are doing when we are looking into the surface properties of the material. All right. So for the Atterberg limits, remember we looked into the behavior of material in different moisture content. Talked about if you had a fistful of soil in your hand and incrementally increase the amount of moisture, essentially the soil initially is solid, then it would be semi-solid, it would be later plastic, and ultimately if you exceed the moisture content beyond the liquid limit, your soil behaves as a liquid. And the definition of liquid was?
No resistance to shear.
state of the material that cannot support any shear stresses. So in very simple terms, it means that you cannot load that system. That's the implication for us civil engineers, right? And then you have the plastic material, which falls, as you can see on the slide, falls between the liquid limit and plastic limit, right? So that would be when the material is like a Play-Doh, you can form it in your hand and you can mold it, and essentially it has some load-bearing capacity. And then below that level, you basically will see that the material is actually going to be friable, meaning that it's going to basically crumble and cannot support any stresses. We had an example of that. If you recall, we talked about the sandcastle, right? If you want to build a sandcastle on the beach, you definitely need to have some moisture content in your soil to be able to form that material. Otherwise, if you go to white sands and grab some material in your hand, you see that as soon as you open your fist, everything just basically falls apart because of the low moisture content and also low cohesional components between the solid grain and the moisture wedges that is happening within the soil. All right, so that's basically what we had in terms of the general behavior. And we talked about the Atterberg limits. Remind me what the Atterberg limits were?
Water content.
There are three Atterberg limits. Three limits. The Atterberg limits, remember your sentence that should start with? It's the moisture content at which something happens. Right. So moisture content, let's think about it in terms of the general state of the material. The moisture content when the semi-solid changes into plastic, what do we call that?
Plastic limit.
Plastic limit. The moisture content when the plastic material changes behavior into a liquid, liquid, right? And far at the end side, we also have the shrinkage limit, which basically means the moisture content below which the soil ceases to change volume when you start adding moisture. So that's basically the general definitions in terms of the behavior of the material. We had another way to define that, and that was associated with the type of test and the way that we run it in the lab, right? That has to do with the liquid limit equipment. Remember the general form of the liquid limit test that we had? You had the Casagrande cup here, and then there is a crank, and with each revolution of this crank, it lifts it up 1 centimeter and drops down, right? So that impact force there will result in the closure of the gap that you already placed at the middle of this soil paste here. And the moisture content correlated to 25 blows and the closure of 1/2 inch of that gap is called the liquid limit. For that, you have to plot your flow curve. Remember what the flow curve was? You had the log of number of load cycles or number of blows, number of each revolution that we had here. And that was plotted versus the water content, W, or omega, or moisture content. So you figure out what would be the best fitting curve or line in those that run through those data points, and ultimately you can figure out what would be the liquid limit of your soil. Right? So that's basically the typical test, and you're familiar with that. The one that I'm showing you here is the handheld one. You guys are high tech. When you go to the lab, we purchase a new set of equipment. So for you, it's going to be fully automatic. All you need to do is just press a button and it does everything automatically for you. So you don't have to do that exercise. So that's basically what we have for the liquid. And then we have the plastic limit. Remember, the way that the plastic limit works is a whole heck of a lot easier than this one. You basically create a small cylinder of 1/2 inch of soil underneath your hand, and you figure out what would be the moisture content that results in the crumbling of that soil. And you report that as plastic. So as you can tell, these are very empirical way to characterize the surface activities. When did they develop this? 1900. Right? Still they're using that. Where are the alternatives to that? X-ray diffraction, thermogravimetric analysis, or other devices or other equipments that we have in order to get an indication of the mineralogy of the aggregate and correlate the mineralogy to the surface activity. This is easy, straightforward. This is something that you can run it in the lab with very straightforward and not a lot of complexity associated with that. If you want to run an XRD, that requires the equipment that is expensive and also requires some sort of training associated with that. All right, Why do we need to know this plasticity and information about the liquid limit, plastic limit, and PI value or plasticity index? Because ultimately we want to classify our soils, right? And that's basically the objective. We're trying to build all these small pieces of puzzles and then push them all together and see where we are going to use this. Right? So don't lose sight of where we are going in terms of the data. All right, so we have fine-grained soils. The way that we figure that out, what would be the surface activity is through the Atterberg limits. We have two types of tests, or basically three types of tests, to be able to get the shrinkage limit, plastic limit, and the liquid limit. How do we determine the shrinkage limit? Remember, we talked about that, right? So you have the material that you place it inside the ring, place it inside the oven, and figure out what would be the moisture content that your soil will not change volume. So very simple and straightforward. We had that in the slides. The pictures are there, and also the information is already outlined in step one. So you can take a look at that one as well. So we got the shrinkage limit, we get the plastic limit, we get the liquid limit, and then we use this information and combine all of those into one plot. And that plot is called the plasticity chart. All right, so let's quickly talk about the plasticity chart and see what is the significance of that and how we can utilize this plasticity chart to be able to classify our soil. All right, so plasticity chart essentially consisted of plotting the PI value versus the liquid limit. What was the PI? Liquid limit minus plastic limit, right? How do you report that? Percentage, why?
The water contents.
These are water contents, right? So remember water contents. Remember we had four major parameters when we look at the phase diagram, right? We had three volumetric relationship, and we had one weight relationship. The weight relationship was water content. Remember all of those, out of those four, three of them were reported as percentage, the other one was decimal. What were the three as percentage?
Saturation.
Degree of saturation.
Porosity.
Porosity and water content, right? Those were reported as percentages. And then you had one parameter that is reported as decimal.
Void ratio.
The void ratio, the E value that we talked about. Very well. All right, so these values are in percentage. All right, so let's see what we have on this plasticity chart. We have three lines on this chart. This is called A line. This is called B line. And what is this one? Not a C line, it's a U line. So we have three lines on the plasticity chart. A line, B line, and U line. The equation for U line is liquid limit equals to 50. The equation for A line is I run my Atterberg limit test, I figure out what my liquid limit is, I figure out what my PL value is, or plasticity, plastic limit is, find the difference between the two, find the value on the y-axis, figure out where it falls in the x-axis, and you can have one point on your plasticity chart, right, based on the Atterberg limits. Now let's talk about the significance of each of these lines, how we can use this in order to properly characterize our soil. We have A line. A line separates silts and clays. B line Thank you. separate low plasticity fines from high plasticity fines, and U line is an upper bound. Alright, let's see what this means. Let's start with the last one, which is the simplest one. It's an upper bound limit. What this means is that if you go to the lab and run your Atterberg limit test and the point falls above the U line, that means that you made a mistake. Go redo it again. There are no points above the U line is possible. There are no possible points above the U line. That's why it's called the upper bound limit. No points above this. All right. A line separates silt and clay material. Remember in the USCS, Unified Soil Classification System, the particle sizes, remember we didn't have any distinction between the clays and silts, right? But if you run the plasticity chart and actually separate them, figure out which one is clay and which one is silt. So that's how they figure out the distinction between silt and clay using the plasticity. Remember, silt, clay, gravel, sand, those were particle sizes, right? But here, based on the activity of the surface, we can have an indication of the particle size. So this would be the significance of A line. And how about the B line? B line separates material that are of low plasticity from the one with high plasticity. So what is the distinction or what is the implication of this liquid limit 50? This means that if you go to the lab and figure out your water content for the liquid limit and it was above 50, that means that that material requires a lot of moisture to flow, right? So it can absorb a lot of moisture. Therefore, it is a highly plastic material. Does that make sense? Otherwise, if it didn't absorb any moisture, it doesn't have any sensitivity to the absorption of the moisture, and therefore your liquid limit falls on the lower end. So that's basically what it means when you're looking at the moisture absorption capacity associated with the liquid limit. So this is the line, or this is the plot that we have. So essentially we synthesize the information that we have from the Atterberg limit and combine them and look at them on the plasticity chart. Later on, when we start talking about the classification of the soils, you'll see that we're going to, again, subcategorize our soils into the fine grains and coarse grain. For the coarse grain, you know the parameters that are important, the particles, top size, gradation distribution, and the geometry of the particles. Those were the ones that we had for the coarse grain material. For the fines, we are not talking about that. We're talking about the surface activity, and the way that we characterize this is through the Atterberg limits, and then the Atterberg limits, we have three parameters, or three water contents, if you will. We have shrinkage limit, plastic limit, and liquid limit. Once you get those, you just basically figure out where the point falls within the plasticity chart, and based on that, you can get an indication of the moisture absorption capacity. And that is very important, and we're going to talk about that when we start talking about the behavior of coarse grain and fine grain soils, hopefully, in a few slides from now. Alright, so any questions here, what we're doing in terms of the classification of fine grain soils? So I'm assuming that we can move forward with the rest of our lecture slides. Remember, this was the general behavior that we had for the PI value or plasticity index, which was the difference between the plastic limit and liquid limit. Very simple and straightforward. This was the shrinkage limit test. Notice that what we have here, we have soil that is within this container here. Obviously, in this specific case, as you can see, the material would not change any volume before oven drying. Once you place it in the oven, the moisture evaporates and the soil will shrink, right? So you're essentially interested in the moisture content below which you don't see that kind of volumetric change there. That's basically the gist of all the shrinkage limit test. This is the process that you're familiar with. This is the step-by-step way that we look at that. And this is the main topic that we're tackling today, and that is the plasticity chart. Notice that you have the plasticity index, the PI value on the y-axis, and you have the liquid limit on the x-axis. one of the things that is important is that just by looking at the PI value, you can get a very empirical sense of the plasticity of your soil and its applicability for your engineering application. For instance, if you're designing the soil underneath the foundation of this building or foundation of an airfield runway, you want to make sure that you're limiting the highly plastic material. Those are deleterious material when you're looking at the foundations or any load-bearing medium that you have. So you essentially want to make sure that that soil mix consists of non-plastic forms. And we talk about what those mean in terms of the non-plastic material. And different agencies have different definitions for that. For instance, if you end up working in transportation infrastructures, such as highway pavements and bridges and things of that sort, see that TxDOT has a requirement on the PI map. The PI requirement for TxDOT is 10. You want to make sure that your soil won't exceed the PI of 10. If it does, it means that the supervising engineer will come in and say that, okay, well, that didn't pass the quality control. So you just basically have to go in and choose the soil that has less plastic material. Okay, going back and take a quick look at this plasticity chart. We're going to talk about all these different components that are written here later on. But the plasticity chart is essentially consisted of three major lines, right? You have the A line, which separates silts and clays. The one that falls above would be the clay material. Below the A line, you have silty material. Right? You have B line, which basically separates material that are of high plasticity and of low plasticity. If it falls on the right-hand side of the liquid limit equals to 50 or the B line, your material is essentially highly plastic. On the other hand, if it falls below that, meaning that your liquid limit was less than 50, your material will be categorized as low plasticity. Low plasticity. So remember when we start talking about the classification of soils, you will see that I put L here for low and I put H here for high. So that's where it's coming from. It's coming from high plasticity, low plasticity. And then below this, you'll see that you have an M here. That would be your silty material. Above that, you will see the C, which is clay, right? So C would be for clay, H would be for high. This is a specific case. Above A line, C. To the right hand side, high. That would be C and then H. That's where it is coming from. Right? If you understand the whole concept here, then you really don't need to memorize where the location is, where the one is located in each region. Alright. So this is a general form of the plasticity chart that we can. And this is another way to look at it. If you're looking at the location of the B line, if your soil falls on the right-hand side of this B line, you're essentially looking at material that are highly plastic. You definitely don't want to place the material in the foundation of the building or any kind of load-bearing system that you basically want to restrict the softening behavior and also the volumetric expansion. You want to make sure that that material is not falling to the right-hand side. And then on the left-hand side would be the material with low plasticity. To the right-hand side of the B line, we call that H or high. To the left-hand side of the plasticity chart, we call that L or low plasticity. So these are essentially conventions for the USCS or Unified Soil Classification System. One other definition that we have before we move forward with an example of Atterberg limits and how you can interpret them when you're looking at the plasticity chart is the concept of liquidity index, or the NI value. Liquidity index, as you can see, is the normalized way of looking at those Atterberg limits, right? So essentially you have the numerator, you have your water content of your soil, that would be the current water content of the soil, PL was plastic limit, and the LL was liquid limit, right? What do I have in the denominator there? I have plastic limit minus liquid limit, or liquid minus plastic limit. What was that? That was the pi value, right? So you have the pi value in the denominator. In the numerator, you have the current status of the moisture of your soil minus the plastic limit. All right, so I mentioned that this is a relative or normalized way to look at the water content of your soil associated with the ranges of water contents. If the liquidity index falls below zero, that means that the moisture content is below the plastic limit, right? What that means is that your soil falls on the brittle solid and solid material that's going to be a friable material. If it falls between, your liquidity index falls between 0 and 1, that would be in the plastic state, and the material will be moldable. And if the liquidity index exceeds 1, that basically means that your water content is actually higher than the liquid limit. That basically means that material flows, right? So that's basically a normalized way to look at the Atterberg limits. We talked about the behavior of the material, so I'm not going to go through that again. We went through it and we talked about it in our previous lecture. These are the shear stress versus shear strain behavior when you're looking at the moisture content of the material. All right, so let's quickly take a look at an example here together. We are looking at a soil that we went to the lab and run the Atterberg limits. So, liquid limit ended up to be 75, plastic limit ended up to be 32. So liquid limit of 75, what comes to mind when you see a material with liquid limit of 75?
High plasticity.
It's high plasticity because it's more than 50, right? 50%. Your water content with liquid limit is greater than 50%. So that probably raises a flag immediately that this is going to be a plastic material. I have to do something about that kind of soil. Later on, we talk about the things that you can do to that kind of soil to be able to neutralize that high activity of the clay. So you can use some stabilizers to essentially dry up the soil. You can use some sort of structural elements to be able to mitigate that volumetric expansion of the soil. So there are different ways to tackle that. We might be able to get a chance to talk a little bit about that at some point. All right, so you have the liquid limit of 75, and you have the plastic limit of 32. What else can I get from these two components? You can get the plasticity index. What is the difference between the liquid limit and plastic limit there?
43.
And then what do I have in my plasticity chart? I have the PI value on the y-axis, and I have the liquid limit on the x-axis.
Right.
So you select 75 on the x-axis, and you select 42 on 3 on the y-axis, and figure out where it falls. Where does it fall in the plasticity chart?
The clay.
It's definitely clay because it's above the A line. Is it highly plastic or? Yes, because it's greater than 50. We already know where that is falling. And if you look at your plasticity chart, you end up with that CH material. Whenever you see CH, you run. That would be a problematic type of soil. We have to figure out a way to be able to leave. All right, any questions here? All right, so let's quickly move forward with the classification of soils. All right, so now we want to see how we can combine all the information that we talked about so far in order to properly classify our soils. But let's quickly talk about the definition of soil classification and see what we mean by classifying soils. classification is a systematic method to categorize soils into most probable groups with similar engineering behavior. It's most probable. It means that this is not the ultimate step. It's the first step for characterizing the engineering behavior of soils. But what do we mean by engineering behavior? Stress and strain? Alright, so let's talk about that individually. Engineering behavior of coarse grain soils. Alright, engineering behavior of coarse grain soils. It means that what kind of mechanical behavior we expect from a coarse grain material. Alright, what kind of engineering behavior would you expect from coarse grain material? You expect for higher strength, you're comparing that with fine grain material, right? Higher strength. Better packing characteristics, which ultimately translates into higher density. Would you agree with that? Once you have a higher strength and you have higher packing characteristics, what can you tell me in terms of the deformation potential? Lower deformation potential or lower settlement characteristics. Now that you have a higher strength, lower deformation potential for the coarse grain soil, what else can you tell me in terms of the mechanical behavior of coarse grain material? Higher strength could be higher modulus values. But strength and modulus are different entities. They're different things. I don't want to get into that discussion, but there are so many researchers that try to find a correlation between the strength and modulus values, and they come up with some equations that are going to be valid only within a small range for the soils. More information than that, hopefully later on down the road, we'll start talking about the soil suction and the role of moisture in the soil. Alright, what else can you tell me? What can you tell me in terms of the permeability of a well-graded gravel, highly compact? More permeability. Notice I mentioned the well-graded gravel. If I talk about, for instance, a poorly graded sand from uniform gradation, you know that statement is not going to be valid, meaning that it's going to have high permeability in that soil. So I'll put the GW here, and later on we'll say that this is going to be a well-graded gravel. Alright, so you have lower permeability in that case. This would be for coarse grain material. Now what can you tell me in terms of fine grain? That you will have lower strength properties in fine grain soils. have higher deformation potential, do we? Now, in terms of permeability of fine grained soils, do we have high permeability or do we have low permeability? We have low permeability. Remember how you defined the permeability from your hydrometers. Permeability was associated with the speed of the traveling water molecule within the soil medium. So the way that you have to think about it is that if I have fine grained soils, an interconnected void system acts as channels of water. Remember we talked about the nanotubes? Nanotubes or those channels of water that the water essentially, water molecule travels within that. So the narrower would be that tube, the longer would be the path of seepage. And therefore, lower would be the speed of traveling more molecule. So for fine grain soil, they have lower permeability. What can you tell me in terms of moisture susceptibility? Moisture susceptibility, in very simple terms, is the potential for the soil to absorb moisture. It would be hot, right? So what are the implications of that? Let's think about one characteristic that you're familiar with. If I have a moisture susceptible material, meaning that it absorbs a lot of moisture, what happens if it absorbs moisture? It will expand, right? What happens when it dries? Shrink. Expansion and shrinking of the soil basically means you see volumetric instability of your soil. The volume of your soil is no longer going to be stable. It's going to expand, it's going to shrink. And it's going to create shrinkage cracks in there, and it's going to basically separate itself, for instance, from the retaining structure that you might have. Those are all different issues that we have. I mentioned retaining structure. What's the retaining structure? Retaining wall. I'm assuming that everybody here drives on I-10. Right. At the intersection of I-10 and Schuster, you probably will see a lot of retaining structure or structures that basically restrict the movement of soil into the highway. That's basically what the role of the retaining structure is. You want to make sure that you're containing the soil and it's not going to basically come in the middle of the highway. When you have difference in the elevation of the soil, you basically create retaining structures to be able to resist the pressure of the soil and also the damages associated with that. So many of you are currently in your houses, you probably will see the rock walls. Right? If your house is in a slope, you probably will see a rock wall, and your neighbors, it's going to be much higher, there's going to be a wall there to be able to restrict the movement of soil. So those are all the things that you have to be very careful about when we're talking about the pyroclastic material. Now what happens if I'm using a type of soil that undergoes a lot of shrinking and swelling? When the moisture comes in, it will expand. What happens to the pressure? The pressure of the wall, right? Now what happens if it undergoes the drying seasons? The moisture evaporates. What happens to the soil? Shrinks, the volumetric shrinkage. And what happens to the separation of the wall and the soil? Basically, we'll see a gap will happen between the wall and the soil. What was the purpose of the wall?
To hold
the soil. So right now, the wall and the soil are essentially separate from one another. Now the soil needs to hold its own weight. And it collapses, and it damages the structure. So you don't want to use material that is highly plastic for your backfill. That's the purpose. All right, so that was one aspect of moisture susceptibility. What else comes to mind when you're looking at moisture susceptibility? Thankfully, we don't have that issue here in El Paso, and that has to do with freezing and thawing potential. So essentially what freezing and thawing means is that when the moisture gets inside the soil, it's wet. During the winter seasons, what happens to the moisture? It freezes. and then it will expand, right? Anything that ties your soil to the volumetric expansion or volumetric change, you have to be very careful with that. Right? So again, freezing moisture inside the soil structure will result in the expansion of the soil. Now, on the other side, one thing that is going to be extremely important, and for those of you who are going to take the pavement design, we extensively talk about that, and that is related to the thawing period. During the thawing period, for instance, if you're in Minnesota, that might happen in March or April timeframe when the ice lenses inside the soil starts to melt. You'll see that the modulus of your soil drops to 25% of its normal value. So what that means is that if during the thawing season an 18-wheeler passes over the bridge, that induces a whole lot different damage compared to when it passes those are extremely, extremely important components that we have to be very careful about. I remember maybe 4 or 5 years ago, I was mentoring on one of the senior design projects. And they were looking at one of the highways here in El Paso, and they were designing their pavements based on the variation of the moisture content and changes in the modulus value. And then in the defense, when everybody was sitting and they were talking to people from the city where they were advisors and all the faculties were sitting in there, the senior design. And the students was talking about the variation of the moisture, and someone from the city of El Paso came in and said, are you suggesting that the moisture content results in the changes of the modulus value of the soil? And our student looked at him and said, that's exactly what I'm saying. And they're not considering that. And that's one of the reasons and one of the issues that we have with our roads here. Because we just basically assign one modulus value to it, and we assume it's going to stay constant throughout the year. Soils are very different from concrete and steel. For concrete, you might be able to do that. For steel, you might be able to do that. But for soils, remember first lecture, those are stress-sensitive material, non-homogeneous material, anisotropic material, non-linear material, and also we are at the mercy of the Mother Nature too. Basically, moisture comes in, it's going to rain, there's going to be freezing temperatures, so we have to consider all of those components in our design. Alright, so let's quickly write those down and see what we can get into the general definitions. Alright, so higher deformation potential, remember we talked about that, higher moisture susceptibility. And we subdivide this moisture susceptibility into two components. What are those? One would be the shrinking and swelling potential. The other one was freezing and thawing potential. And what I just mentioned about the variation of the modulus value, let's go and take a look at that. MR would be the resilient modulus of your soil, and this would be time in the year. Basically, we'll see this kind of behavior on the soil. Let me just quickly outline this for you. Let's assume we start with fall. So during the winter time, moisture freezes inside the soil and the soil becomes stiff. Do you agree with that? So what the modulus value will tend to go off. And this would be during the thawing season. And it's relatively going to be a shorter period of time. In fact, again, that comes from the discussions that we will have in our pavement design class, and you will see that the damages on the pavements are going to be closely associated with the variation of the subgrade soil modulus values. And ultimately, you go back to there, it's called the summertime recovery of the modulus values. All right, so higher moisture susceptibility, that's how we can subcategorize them. What number are we here? Three, four. that will have lower permeability. And that's something that we talked about. In fact, the lower permeability is going to be helpful for less moisture being in this one. And when we start talking about the moisture barriers, into the, for instance, clay core of the earth dams, you see that we can use low plasticity material of fines to be able to extend or increase the length of seepage, and ultimately we'll see lower moisture intrusion in the dam.
All right, so what was that, what was the y, you know?
MR, resilient modules. It is synonymous with the elastic modules, but there's a difference. For the soils, remember in the first lecture we talked about soils are stress sensitive. If I apply just a little bit of load, you'll see that you kick out the air void and the medium becomes stiffer. So for the resilient modules, what that means is that depending on which definition you look at, you'll see that initial load applications will result in the deformation. Say, for example, the first 200, we remove that and put it aside, and then we'll use the deformation that we have after 200 resiliency of the. That's the reason they call it the 200 modules. But that would be a whole different discussion for a different time. Let's go ahead and take a look at the definition before we move forward. So soil classification essentially has to do with classifying soils into groups with similar behavior. And those behavior are essentially the engineering behavior that we talked about. Again, we subcategorize them into the course and find that they have an entirely different engineering behavior. Also different engineering applications. And we are going to use simple indices. These simple indices are essentially coming from what we talked so far. What are those simple indices? They're coming from gradation, right? The sieve analysis that we did, right? So for the sieve analysis, remember we extracted two parameters. We extracted C sub C and C sub U values. Coefficient of uniformity, coefficient of curvature, those are coming from the gradation distribution chart that we had, right? And then we had information about the plasticity of the material. Liquid limit, plastic limit, and the plasticity index that we basically can look at them in the plasticity chart. And then we would like to go to the general guidance about the engineering properties of the soil through the accumulated experiments. All right, so we have the simple indices here. We have the GSD, liquid limit, and plastic. What is the GSD? German Shepherd dog. No? It's a grain size distribution. That would be your grain size distribution there, and this is what you get your C sub C and C sub U. So this is going to be information about the coarse grain. Liquid limit and plastic limit are coming from the fine grains. And then we want to classify it, and that would be the common language that we have. For instance, we talked about it so far. We said that if I have a CH material, which would be a clay with high plasticity, you know, that would be the type of soil that undergoes a lot of volumetric expansion. It's going to be moisture susceptible, and you have to be careful with that. And estimate engineering properties, and ultimately use it for a specific engineering purpose. And remember, for instance, the engineering purposes that we have is, one, a load-bearing medium, right? So you know what kind of material you have to use. Definitely you have to use a coarse grain material, well graded, to be able to get a good packing, to be able to get good stiffness properties, low deformation properties, excuse me, and things like that. Now, how about if I want to design a drainage layer? Again, I go for the coarse grain material, but in this case, I go for a poorly graded system, right? That would be the case that you have drainable. Now, what if I want to design a system that does not allow for the moisture to pass through? Do I use a coarse grain or fine grain?
Fine.
Use a coarse grain because
better packing.
You're not going to use that. You're going to use a fine grain material. I'm going to use a fine grain material, but do I use a material with high plasticity or a low plasticity? Low plasticity because of the volumetric expansion characteristics. So a good material for core of an earth would be sand or clay with low plasticity. ML, CM materials. ML is silt with low plasticity. And CL is clay with low plasticity. Are suitable materials for core of earth forms. That's the engineering purpose. So, in very simple terms, we don't have bad materials. We have to engineer our materials, and we have to figure out what would be the problem.